Okay, in this next video blog, I wanted to discuss a documentary film on Netflix entitled The True Cost. It's by Andrew Morgan, I believe. Sorry, I'll make sure I get his name right before I end. But anyway, so it's basically about the environmental impacts of fashion on the environment today. The reason why I want to talk about things like this is because I've been trying to bring out these issues for like quite a long time, relationship issues and the way people relate to each other, to the planet, to money and materialism, and especially the word addiction. This documentary gets into a lot of issues on materialism, and I encourage people to watch this documentary. So I'm just going to actually play the documentary on Netflix with the volume turned down and read from the captions. I already made some notes, and it goes on to talk about, one fashion designer admits that fashion has become only in the interests of big business, which I would kind of maybe like to sort of even pause and correct and say, I mean, is it really in the interest of big business to, you know, to be an addict and to just be like an endless consumer of money while getting everybody else addicted to cheap clothing? I mean, I don't believe that it's in the interest of anyone to destroy the planet and destroy the lives of other people. Nobody benefits from that. The documentary says that in the 60s, 95% of the clothing was still made here in the U.S., and today it's only about 3%, and that 97% has been outsourced, he says, to developing countries. I don't know, they're not really developing too well, though, according to this documentary. This one man in the documentary says that over the last 20 years, clothing is deflationary, that the price has gone down over time. Now, has our cost gone down? Right, the cost has not gotten down. The cost has actually gone up. The more production that's been outsourced, the cheaper prices have become on the clothing that people buy, making way for a whole new fashion model known as fast fashion. So instead of fast food, right, it's like fast fashion, almost overnight, transforming the way clothing is bought and sold. So the newest H&M store they talk about on Fifth Avenue in, of course, New York City, the company's largest store. One journalist in the UK for The Guardian, she talks about, so instead of there being like seasons, you know, it used to be seasons, the clothing would come out according to the different seasons, so we don't have that anymore. So instead of there being two seasons a year, they've invented a 52-week season, so you have something new coming out every week. I mean, this is crazy. This is like ADD, fashion. I mean, it's ridiculous. And the fast fashion has created this so that it can essentially shift more product. You know, they show stores like Zara, H&M, all these you know, happy shoppers trying to get clothing like cheap. Stores like Topshop is basically saying that clothes are being made to be disposable, like throw away clothing. And this film actually features someone who I've interviewed for the peoplesinternetradio.com, John Hillary, formerly of waronwant.com. And he says the making of the clothing has been outsourced to low-cost economies, particularly where wages are very low and kept low. And what that means is that those at the top of the value chain get to choose where the products are being made. And they get to switch if, for example, one factory says, we can't make it that cheap anymore. The brand will say, well, we're not going to come to you anymore. And we're going to switch to another place which is cheaper. So the point that I, again, like wanted to make is because I have studied, noticed incredibly due to experience, and studied intensely the dysfunctional abusive family system and dysfunctional abusive relationships, addiction, codependency, things like that, just trying to warn people to recognize the signs and signals of codependent dysfunctional behaviors with the the relationships, the people around you. But I also was aware and used to pay attention to that also at a workplace, at a job, and how it's important to feel valuable at a job. I've just had experiences in my past with abuse, and so much so that I was so on the lookout. Nobody wants to be abused, and so when I wanted so much to, be something in life, to, get somewhere in life, to be treated right, to be valued. And so I would be looking at in the workplace, to be just as valued as you should be, at home. And, I had experiences where, of course, you don't feel valued in a workplace. And I mean, I wasn't working at the, lowest level like these people in these garment factories are. And yet I still felt like I was being, enslaved or kind of oppressed. And, you're there for the company, like at your own expense. And so they go to India, and the owner of this garment factory says that in the West, he doesn't say the company name, he just says in the West, they're using everyday low price to get people in the store. So every day they're hammering me, and I'm hammering my workers. This is how it is. This, I won't say his name. He's just in the True Cost documentary on Netflix. He says they're competing. The stores are competing. When the stores are coming to us for an order and negotiating, look, that particular store is selling this shirt for $5. So I need you to sell it at $4. So you better squeeze or we're going to squeeze. And then the other store is coming and saying, hey, they're selling that at $4, so at target price is $3. And you're getting business, otherwise you're not getting the business. And he's saying, so because we want that business so badly, and we don't have any other options. So every time we're actually trying to survive. So ultimately, something's got to give. So again, the reason why I felt so moved to make this video blog is because I want, like, what this man is essentially saying is no different than, like, anyone, you know, a man who goes to work and feels all stressed out and abused or mistreated at his job, and then comes home and literally, like, you know, beats up his wife and family and says, right, like, you know, I have no choice. So that's the point that I'm trying to make, is this entire global system. You know, again, like, I studied the abusive dysfunctional family system from personal experience of my own, and trying to teach people about relationship skills and treating people good and having value, you know, treating others with value, you know, all of my life, you know, just to end up here in 2017 now, where it's like the abusive family system is just gone global. And I mean, this is ridiculous. So I mean, why can't people just start to say no? I mean, if you just keep lowering your value and lowering and lowering, I mean, a $5 shirt, a $4 shirt, a $3 shirt, I mean, this is ridiculous. Like, where is the humanity? Where does the self-worth? Where does the value of other human life and the planet? Not to mention the planet. I mean, you have to see what's being done to the earth in order to make a $5 shirt. So the garment owner says, you know, eventually something has to give. So exactly, then why don't the people that have the most give? Why is it the people that have the least give? Of course something has to give, right? The most vulnerable, the people that have the least, are always doing the most giving because they're being literally pushed to their brink. And so they're saying, so, right, like, the price has to go up or the factory has to get shut down. I mean, so, I mean, just charge what something is worth. Pay people what they're worth. It talks about cutting corners, disregarding safety measures, has become an accepted part of doing business until an early morning in April. I think it was like 2015. It doesn't have the date. Maybe it was 2016. An event outside of Dhaka, Bangladesh, brought a hidden sign of fashion to front page news when a garment building collapsed and killed over 1,100 people. Of course, mostly young women and girls. I'm just going to clarify, in this documentary, it says 70 people. In an article that I looked up about it, it said over 1,100. I mean, ultimately, that's how many people were discovered buried beneath the rubble. They could still hear. They could hear people, rescue workers racing against time, searching through the rubble, trying to find as many survivors as they can. Hundreds dead. Hundreds more still buried alive. Factory owners ignored safety regulations. Garment workers in Bangladesh paying for the price for cheap clothing. And so in the article that I read about this, it was in something called Rana. Rana, R-A-N-A, was the name of the facility, the garment facility, I believe. And so the workers noticed cracks in the building like the day before, and they refused to go in, and they were forced by the work, the boss, whatever, to, you know, to go into the building, like, despite them refusing to. But again, the point that I'm trying to make is that, you know, in abusive relationships, you know, the signs and symptoms of abuse, you know, are there, you know, long before. And I mean, like, the fact that, why don't we hear about this stuff before the people die. When the people die, then you hear about it. But you don't hear about it before then. I mean, something should be heard about before this amount of people die. Because this, again, the signs and symptoms of abuse, I mean, you're already being killed already. I'm just trying to point out the signs and symptoms of, you know, things going in this direction are already so clear. I mean, the thing that can't be gotten over clearly are the laws of physics. When the building collapses, that's it. Then the documentary goes on to show and speak to an Indian woman in Bangladesh who was working in this factory when it collapsed and who lost both of her legs from being trapped. And again, like, my point is, like, the signs of being diminished, the signs of being in a relationship where you're being used are there already. Like, the people were already being diminished, and now this woman lost her legs, so now she's even more diminished. You know, like, recognizing the signs and symptoms in the first place. I mean, when I was studying, you know, the abusive family system, it's like recognizing the signs and symptoms of abuse. I mean, I'm going to bring up Nicole Brown Simpson. I mean, she knew she was going to die. I mean, when we're literally living in just, you know, mass scale domestic violence situations. I mean, you know, if there was a... Again, I'm just going to use the example, you know, because I know that there are other examples of, you know, wives abusing their husbands, but most often it's an abusive husband, you know, abusing the wife or the kids. I mean, if in front of where I live, a man out in the street was beating up his wife and perhaps even killing her, like, out in the street. I mean, of course, like, something would be done. You know, that would be seen as abnormal. But yet we have mass-scale domestic violence, abusive situations going on. And, you know, right, people have to die. Recognizing the abuse first, you know, isn't, you know, doesn't happen. The people have to be murdered. And the sad part about it is, you know, I mean, like, these people, right, like, they might be used to living in, you know, minimal conditions in their homes, in their lives. And so, again, like, instead of these corporations, these companies coming in, you know, they're not looking to come in and help these people and lift the, you know, them up. They're just exploiting them. They're just taking advantage of their naivety, you know. And there's people in this documentary that are actually, you know, making excuses for sweatshops, like, being okay and acceptable. This one woman formerly working for Joe Fresh says there's nothing inherently dangerous about sewing. But when you're being paid much less than your worth and what you should be getting paid, and a building is falling on you, yes, being abused is dangerous. Even if you're sewing and you're, you know, you're being abused. So, right, it's Rana Plaza, R-A-N-A Plaza. 2 weeks, you know, they're looking for people buried alive. The death toll was over 1,100 when I looked up the article, which made it the worst garment industry disaster in history. In this documentary, it shows a CBS newscast of the anchor saying that many clothes are made in Bangladesh by workers who earn about $2 a day. I mean, again, no wonder why for-profit prisons are popping up all over the U.S., because this is exactly what corporations are looking to do to everyone in this country. This is going to be a third world country if the people don't start rising up. Okay, just a couple of more points and then I'm going to wrap it up because, I mean, I can't go through this whole documentary, but they show you a Monsanto advertisement in the documentary saying, Monsanto is proud to be the industry leader in agricultural innovation because of what these agricultural advancements can do to help you double yields for the future needs of the world. That they're dedicated to the future of agriculture and improving farmers with innovations that help them procure more and conserve more while improving the lives of people around the world. Together we can face the challenges of the next generation and beyond. Monsanto. I mean, you know, give me a break. Like, I mean, who believes that? I mean, who doesn't know by now that Monsanto is nothing but Frankenstein? I mean, it's all about like giving, I mean, nature a freaking makeover. I mean, that's all we're doing on this planet is making like Frankenstein. I mean, what knows better than nature? I mean, again, like all I've been teaching myself, all of my life, trying to teach other people because nobody taught me anything when I was a kid. In fact, they were actually pulling the rug out from under me and criminalizing me when I was saying any of this stuff, trying to educate myself and teach them anything. Nature is the most intelligent thing there is. You know, listening to your gut, trusting your instincts, which is also, being destroyed. And, and here's Monsanto trying to act like they know better than nature does. Give me a break. So in this part, it's Dr. Vandana Shiva, who I always admired. I heard her speak before. And she says, after the wars, where all these redundant factories that have made war chemicals, explosives were lying around. The Western countries thought it would be a good idea to market them to the third world. After all, the same industry that makes explosive makes nitrogen fertilizers, and they started to push nitrogen fertilizers from the 50s, 1950s onwards after they became independent. But the nitrogen fertilizers don't do very well with native crops. There's a problem of lodging. So the whole system then organized itself to redesign the plant in order to take on more chemicals. So here it is, folks. Man knows better than nature. Nature is being forced, right? Don't listen to nature. Override what nature says in order to take on more chemicals. I mean, I'll just leave it there because it just, it's crazy. So, Dr. Vandana Shiva talks about BT cotton, that it's a cotton in which a gene has been added from a bacteria to produce a toxin. But the BT cotton, which is supposed to control a pest, has been offered because it's a way for the companies to own the seed. By patenting these genetically modified plants, Monsanto has become the largest seed and chemical corporation in history. I wanted to speak, they wanted to speak to somebody who was willing to talk. Okay, so that's it, the True Cost documentary on Netflix. Let's start getting back to health and nature. No one is, it's in no one's best interest to abuse other people and the environment for profit. Real profit is everyone, a world for everyone who, you know, benefits together, not some benefiting at the expense of others. That's not how nature works. That's man overriding how nature works.